Most parents are wary of the so-called heavy metal music.
Salut à tous, Metal Excess, c'est l'essentiel de l'actualité métal et dérivé en quelques minutes, le tout en images, en musique et en interview. Metal Excess est une exclusivité Refix by Crédit Mutuel, la plateforme de toutes les musiques, tous les talents en partenariat avec Artforce. C'est parti! De la rage, de l'énergie, de l'émotion sont trois qualités que l'on retrouve dans Saint Agnes, l'un des groupes sensations qui émerge ces dernières années de la scène britannique et surtout depuis la sortie de Bloodsuckers, premier album sur le label Spine Farm et second de sa discographie. Jusqu'à présent foncièrement indépendant, cela fait pourtant déjà 10 ans que Kitty Arabella Austin et John Tufnell, leaders de Saint Agnes, écument les circuits et éprouvent leur rock alternatif qui flirte autant avec le punk, le grunge que le hardcore et le metal. Le 6 février prochain, Saint Agnes sera de passage à Paris pour un concert en tête d'affiche, mais d'ici là, retour tout d'abord sur ces dernières années qui ont construit une formation plus déterminée que jamais. En juin 2020, Saint Agnes sortait The Quarantine Diaries, 5 reprises digitales dont une de Wish de Nine Inch Nails, parmi d'autres de Cher ou encore de Lana Del Rey. En quoi ces réinterprétations sont-elles révélatrices de leurs influences?
Yeah, that was a really odd time, The Quarantine Diaries. You've just taken me straight back to the middle of COVID and that crazy time. Mm-hmm. And we were living in London, in a flat in East London. And we're kind of going out of our minds, really. Mm-hmm. Being trapped in our flat, going to a supermarket in masks, it was insane.
I'm wondering if we were ever going to get to be musicians again.
Yeah, because you know, all of our shows have been cancelled mm-hmm. for the next year. Every show gone overnight. So we struggled, didn't we?
We did really struggle, and we decided to counteract the despair that we were feeling with a goal of choosing a song, recording a cover, and making a video on a phone in one day. That was the goal.
Yeah.
The goal. So we just decided Nine Inch Nails, Wish, that's a great song. I think that was maybe the first one, and we just record a cover, do a video in one day. And we found it so important to give us a focus that we thought, what else can we do?
Yeah.
And yeah, we just chose our influences. We didn't spend ages choosing. We just, as soon as we thought that's a cool song.
Let's just try.
Let's see. You know, all we had was time. Everyone in COVID had loads of time, right? Yeah. And so Nick Cave, Lana Del Rey.
Yeah, it was just all songs we really liked, and we just thought, fuck it, like, there are no rules now. Like, maybe before there were certain songs that St. Agnes could cover that people would be like, that makes sense. As soon as it was COVID and quarantine and all that stuff, we were like, well, there's no rules now, so we can make a Nancy Sinatra song or Lana Del Rey, stuff that people wouldn't think, oh, St. Agnes can cover that.
Yeah, it wasn't really an official release, it was just a way to keep us
sane.
From going crazy.
Yeah. We released an EP, The Family Strange, on the day that lockdown was announced in the UK, which was unfortunate.
Yeah, not ideal.
And then we wrote another EP called Vampire, so we did that during lockdown. And then I think the songs for Bloodsuckers, it's post-COVID, right?
Yeah, it was all post-COVID. Like, Bloodsuckers came together kind of in its own time. Like, mm-hmm. We'd had the challenge of COVID, and just as we were coming out of COVID, the first thing we did was we went on tour with a band called Skindred. And that was an amazing experience. But on the last date of that tour, we got a phone call from Kitty's family saying that unfortunately her mother had gone into hospital unexpectedly, and it was really serious and we needed to rush down. And that was the beginning of a really challenging time, and kind of also the beginning of the Bloodsuckers writing era. Mm-hmm. Kitty lost her mother in a really unexpected and tragic way, and decided to embrace the pain and the emotions and create something positive from it, which was the music that you hear on Bloodsuckers.
Mm-hmm. Ont-ils profité aussi de cette période pour composer ou différer l'écriture?
Yeah, so we started making the album in the weeks and months that followed my mum dying unexpectedly. And I was saying before, like, it was just something I needed to do. Like, I make music, I write songs, whatever's happening in my life, I'm making things, art, songs, poems, like, I just create things. So when this happened, like when my mum died, the trauma of that just kind of, it was obvious I was gonna make something from it, because mm-hmm. that's just what I do to cope. Like, it's how I guess it's how I get through things, and how I understand myself better is by making stuff, art, mm-hmm. I guess, things. Mm-hmm. So we started making the record, and it was really difficult. We recorded it all ourselves, mm-hmm. at home, like at my home, and we had to work in a way that was like, right, I feel like I can do this today, I feel like I can sing today, so we need to like
embrace
work now.
Yeah.
And then there'd be a day where I'd be like, I can't do anything today, I'm just in bed, like, or on the floor, like, I can't cope today. So that's how we worked, this very chaotic.
Mm-hmm. I think that the nature of emotion is that it's something that is transitory, it happens, it comes in waves, and because of that, we weren't able to, Kitty wasn't able to sing a song and then the next day sing it again and then sing it again. It was just once, it was in that moment. You had to embrace the emotion of the moment.
Because it was, the emotions were just leaking out of me. It was so raw and difficult. And we did think a few times, is this like the thing I should be doing right now?
Is this healthy?
Is this healthy to be this in touch with my emotions and letting it all just come out?
And yeah, we decided to be bold and embrace it. And for me as an artist, it was a real privilege to work with someone who was willing to create art in a moment that a lot of people would choose to wait until later. And with the vocals in particular, I was the engineer, I was the producer, and I was sat with headphones on with my back to Kitty, and she'd be singing and I would think, this sounds amazing, and I would turn round and she'd be on the floor crying or throwing the microphone against the wall because of the raw emotion. And I had a real conflict of excitement over how good it sounded and real sadness about seeing my best friend in pain. So it's a very conflicting and difficult time, but I think the most poignant art comes out of these complex moments.
Cette énergie brute, on l'entend à la fin du titre Animal.
But that's a perfect example. Yeah. In the last chorus of that song, you hear the microphone hit the wall. And that was,
it all got too much, and I felt like very angry, and we captured it, and then it was like, yeah, done. Like, you know,
yeah.
It's more interesting to me to capture imperfections, and because I think it's authentic. Not always, but I think it's like, and that's what I'm interested in, is art that's like as authentic as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And it can be art, it can be anything. It can be like, I don't know, literature or film or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's, for me, it's always about if it feels authentic.
Everything in the world now is edited. Mm-hmm. Every photo, like, it used to just be that the photos on the front of a magazine would be airbrushed, but now every personal photo, you take 100 and you choose one, and then that one has a filter, and every single thing is edited and presented in a certain way. So it feels jarring and confrontational to have the ugliness of mistakes and reality and humanity.
This has got to mean more than just the end.
Et c'est la raison pour laquelle Saint Agnes a choisi de sortir une vidéo du titre This Is Not The End qui soit enregistrée dans les conditions live.
Yeah, that's it exactly.
Yeah, we did the album version of This Is Not The End. Was a very spontaneous, very raw. Kitty sang it once. There's one version. That was it. And then when we made the video, we realized
it kind of felt wrong to make a music video for that song because it is so personal. The idea of like manufacturing a music video for it just didn't feel right at all. So I had the idea of, actually no, it was our, so Dante, our label manager, said, I know it doesn't feel right to make a music video, but I really think we should highlight this song because he thought it was valuable and was like, why don't you go and do a live performance of it? And that felt perfect. It was mm-hmm. like, yeah, we'll like get together. We went up to Rockfield Studios in Wales, in England.
Where they recorded Bohemian Rhapsody.
Yeah, so we went to this legendary kind of studio. It was very cool. Mm-hmm. And we did this piano version of it. And again, like it was just, we played it three times maybe and chose one of the performances.
Chose one performance, yeah.
And that
and
felt-
that's the video.
Yeah, that felt right.
Yeah. Yeah, very emotional day again.
Yeah, tough
that,
day.
That song is always going to be difficult for Kitty and for us to see Kitty.
Yeah.
It's always going to be hard.
Yeah.
I'll shine a light for you, a light for you to find. This has got to mean more than just the end. I don't know how else to live. This is how I survive. Just because I'm dreaming doesn't mean this is goodbye, yeah. This is not goodbye, yeah. I can never say goodbye, yeah. I'll find a place for you inside.
I really wanted to have one song on the record that was directly about grief and about my relationship with my mum. I found it too really difficult to do that, to like open myself up that much. I found that really difficult. So that song was recorded about a week before the deadline for like, right, you've got to send this off for mastering. Because I'd been delaying and saying, oh, I can't, it's too hard, I can't do it. So it was, yeah, it came together in like an afternoon, didn't
it? Yeah,
very quickly, we wrote it very quickly, wrote the words very quickly, recorded it that evening,
mm-hmm.
just did it super mm-hmm. fast.
The best way to capture an emotion is to not think about it. Don't try and turn an emotion into something other than what it is. And you do that by just working quickly, being spontaneous, and accepting what the results are. And we did that with that song, and I'm incredibly proud of being part of something like that.
This is not goodbye, yeah. I can never say goodbye, yeah. I'll find a place for you inside. 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 I'll find a place for you inside.
I had a really difficult relationship, well, both my parents, but with my mum, a really difficult relationship. And a lot of the songs touch on things that she made me feel and how she made my life difficult. But ultimately, I think like This Is Not the End encapsulates the feeling I had when she got sick, which was all of that stuff is like kind of like noise. And when you're in like a kind of life or death situation, all that stuff just moves out the way. And you can kind of separate things. So I could separate out the hurt and stuff and the difficulties and the fact that we really loved each other as well. And these things became like a lot clearer and a lot easier to cope with. You know, I could exist having a difficult relationship with my mum, but also a really loving relationship. Both those things were true. And I think when you're in those situations, it all becomes a lot clearer.
Mm-hmm.
Sur Bloodsuckers, Saint Agnes accueille Mimi Barks, la musicienne de doom trap allemande, pour le titre Body Bag.
She's really, really cool. She's London-based as well. She's from Germany, but she lives in London. And we asked her to come and support us on tour, like in 2020.
Just before we started recording our album.
Right?
Yeah.
So she came on tour and we were like, she's amazing, amazing support for us.
We really respected her work ethic. She reminded us that
very intense
very
and driven and like it's all about the art, which was really cool. And we kind of wrote the song thinking like with her in mind, thinking oh, it'd be ace to have like Mimi on a song. So we kind of had that in our minds when we were writing it. And it's just like a minute and a half of just
pure rage.
It's cool.
We kind of wanted to have one song on the album that felt almost like we wanted to acknowledge the rage that was on the album. We wanted to do one more. At the moment that your opponent is laying bloodied and bleeding and bruised, we wanted to have one more attack. And that song felt like the perfect thing to do.
Posséder sa propre structure indépendante jusqu'à présent. Qu'est-ce qui les a poussés à signer avec le label Spine Farm?
It's down to one person,
one
actually.
Person.
So Dante Benuto, who's like head of A&R with Spine Farm in the UK. And we'd known him for a long time. He started coming to our shows really
right
early
from the
on.
Start.
Like, and would come consistently to the point where we became friends rather than, oh, it's some guy from a record label. It was like, oh, amazing, Dante's here. And we would like, you know, hang out with him and stuff like that.
He likes all the same music we do. We just talk about
endlessly.
Records that we love.
It's so boring. For anyone else who's there, it is just mind-numbingly boring.
Super geeks about records, yeah.
But so we'd always, you know, talk loosely, like, oh, we should work together at some point, blah, blah, blah. And I think, like, Bloodsuckers was such a personal album for me and so important. I was very hesitant to work with a major label. I was very like, oh, I don't know if this is the record I'd like to, you know, work with other people on because it feels so personal. But having that relationship with Dante and that trust, it was actually like, yeah, of course I want to work with Dante.
Yeah.
I wouldn't trust anyone else with it, really.
He treats our music with absolute respect. There was not one moment where the label said to us, you should do this, you should write a song like this. There was nothing. They just said, you do what you want to do because we love the band and no one knows Saint Agnes better than you. Be Saint Agnes and we'll release it.
And that's incredibly rare from a label, you know, like.
Yeah, and it was perfect. So we're very happy. Yeah.
Outside.
Saint Agnes nous a accordé une session acoustique dont vous pouvez apprécier de nombreux extraits dans cette interview, un exercice totalement nouveau pour le groupe.
That's the very first time we've ever done it. We're not acoustic people.
Yes, you know, aggressive, nice... like loud, angry music. It's hard to translate it to acoustic, but it does. Yeah. It's cool.
And so we wanted to do Outsider because it sums up a lot about what we're about as a band. The idea that you don't really fit in, and that song is written as a thing to our younger selves, to picture ourselves in a playground at school when you're feeling lonely and sad, and be the big brother that you wish you had come over and say everything's going to be okay. That song, and that's really important to us. And then This Is Not the End, which lends itself really well to the acoustic format because it leaves so much room for Kitty to just express herself vocally.
C'est en électrique et avec toute son énergie ravageuse que Saint Agnes chauffera la salle des étoiles le 6 février à Paris. Avant que le groupe ne devienne trop gros, profitez d'une des rares occasions de le voir encore en condition club. Parmi les albums attendus dans les prochains jours, notez sur vos tablettes. Moins de 4 ans d'existence, et le groupe allemand Cobblekill s'est déjà taillé une solide réputation d'héritier de son hard rock et metal US des 80s. Serpent's Kiss, ce sont 12 titres qui composent son deuxième album, le premier sur le label Frontiers. Deuxième disque également est sur le même label pour Grand. Second to None, nouveau projet du duo suédois, est destiné à tous les inconditionnels de rock puissant, sophistiqué et mélodique tendance AOR. Ça a beaucoup spéculé sur ce que Green Day allait nous réserver pour son 14e album, après un précédent disque qui s'était largement aventuré dans les racines garage du trio. Après 4 singles en 3 mois, réponse complète avec Saviors. Horsk, 15 ans d'existence, l'une des formations les plus actives de la scène française d'électrometal sort Body. Son troisième album, considéré déjà comme plus mélodique et plus aventureux que Gate et Wire. On vous en reparlera prochainement dans Metal Excess. On quitte la Franche-Comté pour la région toulousaine avec le trio Slift et son troisième disque Ilion, un metal rock psychédélique dont la trame narrative sur fond de science-fiction intergalactique a, excusez du peu, séduit le label culte Sub Pop. Le groupe de post-hardcore de Los Angeles, Touché Amoré, a décidé de ressusciter son troisième album Is Survived By, paru en 2013, en publiant Is Survived By Revived, bénéficiant d'un mix et d'une masterisation réactualisée, sans oublier une déclinaison en vinyle de couleurs et de pochettes différentes. Direction Pittsburgh, en Pennsylvanie, d'où Underneath balance son hardcore entre metal et death sur l'album 13 titres From the Gate of Gaia. Du mélodique death metal cette fois, en provenance de San Fernando Valley, avec Upon Stan et son album 9 titres Dead Mother Moon, dont une reprise des Misfits, Dig Up Her Bones. Autre groupe culte dont la fondation avoisine les 45 bougies à New York, gloire éphémère mais ultra respectée des années 80, reformé il y a une quinzaine d'années, le trio The Rhodes dégaine son 10e album de pur heavy metal, Rattle the Cage. Vous ne connaissez pas Gotus, et pourtant les musiciens ne sont pas des inconnus. Ronnie Romero au chant, Mandy Meyer qui a officié entre autres dans Gotthard et Crocus, et quelques autres compères suisses du même tonneau. Gotus, son deuxième album, ne décevra pas les fans de hard rock. Pépinière de guitaristes spectaculaires pendant une poignée d'années avec Yngwie Malmsteen, Steve Vai et le moins médiatisé Danny Johnson, Alcatraz a toujours eu ce statut un peu référentiel malgré une carrière en très gros pointillé. Rock Justice Complete Recordings 1983-1986 est un coffret qui regroupe les 3 premiers albums du projet fondé il y a 40 ans par le chanteur Graham Bonnet, ainsi que des sessions rares ou inédites enregistrées entre 1985 et 1986. Après une vingtaine d'années au sein d'Alkaline Trio, la formation de punk rock originaire de l'Illinois, Derek Grant a laissé son tabouret à Adam Willard, tout en s'étant préalablement acquitté des sessions de ce 10e disque intitulé Blood Hair and Eyeballs. On s'y connaît en métallurgie dans le Ruhr. Any Given Day, le groupe de metalcore allemand, délivre son 4e album Limitless, le premier post-pandémique. Lucifer, qui a entre autres des racines aussi en Allemagne, égrène depuis plus de 8 ans ses albums aux titres tous plus inventifs les uns que les autres. Remarquez, on ne peut pas se tromper, c'est le 5e et il s'intitule Lucifer 5. Il est toujours aussi doom heavy rock. Du métal progressif dans toute sa palette et sa richesse en provenance d'Australie, c'est le 6e disque de Caligula's Horse, Charcoal Grace. Frank Carter et ses Rattlesnakes poursuivent leur ascension et une évolution certaine avec Dark Rainbow, 5e œuvre de leur discographie, décrite comme un regard nouveau sur des inspirations du passé qui avaient été laissées de côté. Plus culte dans la scène indie rock punk britannique que New Model Army, pas possible. Après le live Symphonia sorti l'année dernière avec un orchestre symphonique, Unbroken et son 16e album studio. Changement total d'univers et de contrée avec Fission, le 2e album de rock avant-gardiste du quartet américain Dead Poets Society. Il s'est fait désirer après avoir été repoussé de plusieurs mois, 3 ans et demi après le premier volume, Project Regeneration, volume 2 de Static X, et le 8e disque de la formation de metal indus californienne, et le dernier avec Wayne Static, au chant, disparu en 2014. Il y a un an, le groupe Thunder Mother implosait, laissant Philippa Nocil s'entourer de nouvelles musiciennes et les 3 autres transfuges monter The Gems. Le trio suédois de hard rock sort son premier album, Phoenix. Les maîtres du deathcore Whitechapel ont immortalisé un concert caritatif enregistré dans leur ville natale de Knoxville, Tennessee. Et cela donne les 13 titres de Live in the Valley, tirés des albums Keen et The Valley.
Hey, have you seen the new Saxon video?
No, what's it called?
There's something in Roswell.
My dad told me about that crash.
I love Saxon. They've got a new album coming out.
Oh, what's it called? Hell, Fire, and Damnation.
Oh, sounds cool. I'll check it out.
À l'écoute du nouvel album de Saxon, on en viendrait à penser que c'est dans les vieilles fonderies qu'on fait le meilleur métal. Hell, Fire and Damnation, 24e disque studio de la formation britannique et d'une efficacité redoutable, est doté d'une production non seulement très ambitieuse, mais surtout très actuelle. Rencontre dans Metal Excess avec l'unique Biff Byford, leader de Saxon et porte-étendard des valeurs du heavy metal, accompagné de son nouveau partenaire de croisade, une autre figure légendaire, le guitariste Brian Tetler de Diamond Head. Hellfire and Damnation semble avoir été réalisé et produit avec une rapidité peu commune.
Yeah, it went fast. I think we always record fast these days. It's the way that we make albums, but this one was particularly fast, yeah, because we did intend to release an album the end of next year, but you know, the with us getting together with Judas Priest to do this tour in March, we had to bring everything forward, so the plans changed. We did have quite a lot written, but nothing finished, if you know what I mean, like we had a box of bits. Yeah, I was working on that. I was working at home on my own with all the musical parts and putting vocals in and taking vocals out and things. So, yeah, and then we had a sense of urgency and I had to get it all together. And yeah, I think we did pretty well, really. I mean, Brian supplied me with a couple of good ideas, two or three good ideas, which helped the process.
Brian Tetler de Diamond Head a rejoint Saxon en remplacement de Paul Quinn. Cela a-t-il changé la façon de travailler de Saxon en studio?
pretty similar. Making albums is pretty similar. There's nothing, I mean, you know, great guitarist plays great guitar on the album, so no, I don't think there's anything different. Just the difference with this album, we had to get it together quicker. I mean, Brian came over to my house, I have a studio there, and we worked on the songs together, his ideas and my ideas together. Some of the other guys contributed a few things. So it's pretty much, you know, a team thing. But the original idea for instance, Hellfire and Damnation, the title track, is Brian's riff. So I heard that riff, you know, on Tuesday, and I think I'd written the vocals on Thursday. So it was very, you know, a very state of grace. Everything was happening perfectly, which doesn't happen very often. But on this album, something magical happened and it came out that we finished it. Actually, a day before the deadline that we were given by the record company, we finished it. I remember phoning on to Snape, and Snape going, "Do you like it?" I was like, "Yeah, it's great. Shall we let it go?" "Yeah, let it go." So that was it, really. And we did the vinyl mix first. The vinyl is a different mix to the CD and the streaming version, so which is quite unusual as well. So there's slightly different things on the vinyl than there is on the CD. So, but that's just a technical thing. But people like it, you know. "Oh, I've got a vinyl, it's a different mix." You know. So yeah.
Où l'on apprend à Biff que l'album sort aussi en format cassette, ce qui donne lieu à une conversation plutôt amusante.
We I don't think we've got a cassette on this album, but I might be wrong, I don't know. But we'd have a cassette on Thunderbolt and Capitium. I like cassettes. I don't know why people buy them anymore.
No.
Because the technology is quite sort of, yeah. It's a bit ancient. But I do have a nice cassette deck, you know, like a Sony double deck, various speed on it. You know, so I like the, I mean, I've got a Porsche, an old Porsche that's got a cassette machine in it. So I do listen to Thunderbolt sometimes. And I've got some of the original Wheels of Steel cassettes, which sound pretty gruesome.
I didn't know anything about a cassette for this.
Yeah.
Yeah. That'd be nice. Yeah. It's very old school, I think.
It's very collectible.
Yeah.
Americans like cassettes. I like the 8-track. But you know, we're moving on now, aren't we? So let's keep it pure.
Et vous serez donc ravi d'apprendre que vous sortez une cassette rouge.
There is no cassette for this album, no, not yet.
Si, si, une cassette rouge.
A red one.
What's that mean, a red one?
Juste dire que la cassette est de couleur rouge.
Okay.
Oh, for this album. Fantastic.
So, they know things we don't know.
Probably they know. I mean, the first time today we've seen, yesterday, we saw the vinyl.
True.
We've not seen the vinyl. Some guy walks in with the vinyl, we were like, "Oh, what's that? How's he got the vinyl? I haven't seen the vinyl." So, that's how quick this album is, you know, you guys have got the vinyl before we got it. And the CD.
And the cassette.
And the cassette, obviously. Anything else you've got we don't know about? Yeah, and t-shirts out there, right?
Posters.
I do know that there's a back patch going to be available of the album cover, which is pretty cool.
From the beginning of time, the powers of good.
L'album débute par la voix de l'acteur Brian Blessed, connu pour son rôle dans le premier épisode de Star Wars, par exemple, ou encore comme Prince Vuldan dans Flash Gordon. Comment en êtes-vous arrivé à travailler avec lui?
Gordon's alive! He's a friend of ours. We've known him for some time. And we did a couple of charities with him for the coal miners in Yorkshire in the 90s. Because he's from that part of the world. He's from Mexico.
Didn't he?
So we did a few things with him, like a charity concert. And he introduced us at Bloodstock. Last year or the year before? Anyway, he introduced us at Bloodstock and...
Year before.
Yeah, he was doing all the Saxons Alive and for you know, for fucking St. George and Saxon. So we liked it. So I said, if I write some words, will you say them for us? And he said, yeah. So we're very lucky, actually, to get him because he's been on a lot of TV adverts and things, so I think he likes the whole rock and roll thing. You know, actors like knowing rock and roll bands. You know, rock and roll bands like knowing actors. It's just one of them things, you know. He's climbed Everest about 7 times.
No.
Of course he has, man.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Fair play.
Yeah, he's a legend, that boy. He's about 80-something.
He is.
Still going strong. He was on TV not long ago, opening something in Doncaster. It's a strange story because the song was actually called Prophecy originally, and it was going to be about the sort of prophecy between, you know, the devil and God and Satan, whatever. And in the chorus was Hellfire and Damnation, written in the prophecy. So the song was called Prophecy. And it wasn't until I heard Brian's riff that I thought I could use that for Hellfire Damnation. It fitted better. And then I wrote Prophecy, which Brian did. So, but the saying comes from my father. My father used to say it to me, and you've heard it.
I have, yeah. Yeah.
It's an old, like, hellfire and damnation, you know, what are you doing, stupid little boy, you know, that sort of thing. So it's very, quite religious, you know. Where I was born was quite countrified, and, you know, I used to go to church every Sunday, like one of those things. So I learned all about the, you know, the end of days and all the prophecies and everything, so just stuck in my head. So when I had that idea, it just connected to the good and evil, really.
Un titre sur lequel la guitare de Brian est immédiatement reconnaissable et se conjugue à merveille avec la musique de Saxon.
Yeah, yeah, it has, it's matched really well. It's, you know, we've managed to come up with some good ideas together. So it's really nice to be able to work with a different, you know, a different singer we've never written together before. So of course you don't know how that's going to go when you start writing with a new partner. It might not work. But in this situation, it worked, and it worked quickly. And Biff doesn't hang about, you know. So he knows what he wants, and he was able to say, I like that, and we need to take that bit out and take this bit out. But on the whole, it came together very quickly, and I'm really pleased with how it's turned out. It's great.
Yeah, there's a certain amount of crafting that goes into making a great song. And I think, you know, the way it's crafted and put together is quite important. So I've been doing it a long time, so I'm quite experienced at crafting songs.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you have to have a vision of what you think it's going to sound like at the end of it. So that's really what my job is in the writing, to have that vision of this song. I think the song's a monster song, actually. It's a great song. That chorus is killer. You know, and when we sang it, I was like, nah. And then Andy put in the echo after Hell.
It's a great idea, that was.
Yeah.
When I'm writing, I don't just come up, you know, you come up with a riff, yeah, and you'd record it. And then, but then I review it, and I might have a riff for years. And if I can get it into a song and I start building the song, then it's got more life to it. It'll last longer somehow. I wouldn't just give riff, you know, if it, like, here's a one riff, you know, on a cassette or something. I try and do the song if possible. I like to try and come up with different parts so it all fits together. And that takes time. You know, I might demo a song 3-4 times before I think it's ready to take on a life of its own, you know. And then, you know, once a singer gets involved, he might say, oh, I prefer that, you know, I don't know what I'm doing there or that, but that bit needs to be longer. And then you finally get the shape of the song.
Dans les textes, Biff ne manque jamais d'inspiration. À l'ère d'Internet et de la technologie, comment travaille-t-il et où puise-t-il ses idées? Dans les années 80, il se documentait dans les livres, mais maintenant...
Yeah, I still do read books. You know, I might read them on my phone rather than a book. It's still a book. You know, documentaries, films, anything really. Very interested in history. It's a great thing to study history, because sometimes you can't believe that our people are stupid that they would do that, but they do. And I think the whole theme of the album is good and evil. Well, there's a lot of I don't suppose something in Roswell particularly good evil, but it's a historic song nevertheless. I take a lot of inspiration from history. And I think bands like Maiden do as well. You know, they have a lot of songs that are very historic based. You know, Alexander the Great, Flight of Icarus, all those, Two Minutes to Midnight, even Run to the Hills is a historic song. You have to package it different so it sounds great, So it's not a history lesson, so it's a great song. That's the secret, I think.
Sur ce disque, Biff, toujours friand d'histoire, s'aventure au-delà des thèmes habituels en abordant la question de Roswell.
Yeah, we have covered UFOs before. I have written lyrics about UFOs. Metalhead is about UFOs, and there's a few songs out there that are UFO based, but this is the first time I've done one about a specific thing that happened. In 1947, I think, and that's it's sort of ground zero for alien UFO. If people are into that, then Roswell is where it starts. So, yeah, I think there is something in Roswell. It would be nice if there was.
Biff fait référence également à son adolescence sur le titre Pirates of the Airwaves.
Yeah, well, I was like 13 years old, maybe 14, maybe 12, I can't remember. And there was a lot of music around in 1962, 63, 64. It was like the beginning of that swinging 60s thing. I didn't really have much to do with it, but I liked the music. I loved that music. And the BBC, there was no radios playing any of that music in England. It was all like classical music or folk music or comedy shows like The Goons and stuff like that. So as a young teenager, we were bored, there was no music to listen to. So these pirate stations were outside the jurisdiction, the British law, so they were able to play the songs and beam them in. So we'd be, I'd be sat in bed with the covers over my head with a little transistor radio and a flashlight, listening for, Rolling Stones or the Kinks or something coming through. Any of that early 60s pop music, rock music, that's what. And it revolutionized the music scene in the UK. In the space of about 12 months, BBC had to make their own radio station called Radio 1, and they employed all the DJs from the boats and the, all these guys were famous to us anyway, and they all came and worked for the BBC. And there wouldn't have been, by the time 1980 came around, when Wheels of Steel and, Whitesnake and Judas Priest and Motörhead were on the radio, that really wouldn't have happened if that had happened in the 60s. Yeah. And Pirates of the Airwaves, it's a good title actually. So, I was looking for the title. I wanted to write something about that. My time as a teenager, listening to music on this little box from Japan, little radio. I mean, the radios were like this big before then.
Yeah.
And the TVs were round.
That's right.
The world was in black and white. But the 60s was massive, all that swinging 60s thing with the mini skirts and the music and, it's crazy.
I suppose it went from vowel that radios to transistor radios.
All the guards had long hair and, it was great. It was a great time, really. My dad let me grow my hair long.
Mm-hmm.
It's cool.
We'll have your hands.
You pagan scum.
You'll soon be dead.
We'll smash thy skull.
The wolves will tear your flesh.
Your skin.
La rencontre entre Vikings et Saxons, c'est une réalité avec cette collaboration entre le groupe et Amon Amarth en 2022, illustrée il y a un mois par un nouveau clip. D'ailleurs, ils n'en étaient pas à leur coup d'essai avec le chanteur Johan Hegg.
Well, he sang on a song called Predator with us. I wanted a dark, deep voice, and I like Johan's style of singing. You can hear everything he sings. There's some melody there. You know, it's not all like, you know, there is some melody there. And I like the Viking rock. You know, I love what they do, or the rowing thing with the audience. It's fantastic. And they're good guys as well, and they're big fans of that 80s movement, you know, the new wave, you know, the Judas Priest and Saxon and Maiden. They're big fans, and we met them years ago in Italy at a festival, and we were drinking as usual, and they were doing they had the big Viking horn thing, so we all went out drinking out their horns, you know, so we've been friends ever since. So they said, will you write some words with us, you know, will you write a song with us? You can do the Saxon lyric and I'll do the Viking lyric. So it was good fun, actually. And then a few months later they said, can you come to Latvia? And I'm like, what? Yeah, come to Latvia, we're shooting the video, we'd like you to be in it. So I said, yeah. That wasn't long ago either. I mean, Paul had already retired by then. So, I mean, they wanted Paul to come, so Paul came along. He's in the video as well, so, yeah.
En avril, Saxon jouera comme invité spécial de la tournée Judas Priest sur deux dates françaises.
Great. I mean, you've not played with Judas Priest, have you? But we've done a few tours with Judas Priest. So, yeah, they're a great band to tour with. The fans love the package, Saxon and Judas Priest together. We did it in America in 2018, I think it was really successful. So yeah, it's good for the fans. And you know, you might not see the two bands together again. You know, you don't know what's going to happen.
Et on retrouvera ensuite Biff et son gang au Hellfest en juin, juste avant le concert de Metallica.
Yeah, just after Metallica, yeah. They're probably like preparing for it already. We'll show them Saxon guys. Yeah, so it should be good, yeah. I'll have a beer with the boys. And I'm sure they'll be sticking around to watch us. We'll certainly be watching them one.
Yeah. Et Metal Excess sera évidemment au rendez-vous du Festival Clissonnet pour apprécier les deux. Voilà, Metal Excess, c'est terminé pour aujourd'hui. On se retrouve dans 15 jours pour un nouveau numéro avec toujours plus d'interviews, de surprises et de contenus inédits. Un immense merci pour votre fidélité et n'oubliez pas de prolonger l'expérience Metal sur riffix.fr. Salut.